Happy Father's Day to all the fathers and grandfathers out there today. Good morning to everybody joining. I'm so happy to have you here. Good morning, kid. Hey, how are you? Love your... Thank you for that beautiful introduction, and welcome to Angelica from Germany. Hello, hello. We have Gosha Opus. Thank you for being here and moderating. Thabi, good morning, good morning. And welcome to everybody. You probably recognized that piece of music. And there's a little backstory that we will share in conjunction with Father's Day. That's the famous Bach minuet in G major and G minor. They form a beautiful set. And it's a piece of music that many of you who have studied piano at some point of your life probably played this. This is a usual introduction to the world of Bach's music. And it comes from a very beautiful, very family-oriented book of music that Bach wrote called The Little Notebook for Anna Magdalena Bach. And a little notebook it was. It was a scrapbook of sorts, and he used it as a way to show his devotion to his family. We're going to talk about the devotion of a father through the lens of J.S. Bach and another great composer who lived 200 years later, but their lives had many intersections, Sergei Rachmaninoff, the famous Russian composer. So we will talk about their life, their beautiful contribution to music, and also how devoted they were to family. We will also pray together. We will offer up a declaration today for all dads, and hear a piece of music that is Bach and Rachmaninoff fused together. So a lot to share today. I'll try not to go too long because I know that many of you are doing festivities today. So I'd love to hear in the chat, what kind of plans do you have today? Perhaps you are celebrating Father's Day with your family. I'd love to hear what you're doing. Perhaps you are commemorating and holding the space in your heart for a father or grandfather who has left this earth, but you're still connected, of course, in spirit. And so I'd love to know what you are doing today. Just to bring you up to date, this has been a packed weekend for us here. We had our youngest daughter, Maya, graduate high school on Friday. Yay! Cannot fathom that she's already 18 years old. Guys, how does the time fly so fast, right? So she is going to be off to Rutgers University, which is about 20 minutes from our house. So happy to have her close by, although she will be living there. But, you know, it's just the passage of life. It's amazing. And had a nice, beautiful graduation party that my parents threw for her yesterday. And it was really lovely. Her friends came out. We had a nice little beautiful dinner. And today we will have a barbecue. So that's what I'm up to. And would love to hear what you are doing today. We have a gorgeous day here in New Jersey. So getting ready for the Jersey tomatoes. We look forward to those Jersey tomatoes with great anticipation because there is nothing quite like a Jersey tomato and a nice slice of bread. Now that I know how to make sourdough bread, this summer is all going to be about the sourdough bread with a sprinkle of olive oil and then the Jersey tomato on top, little sea salt, little black pepper, and we are good to go. All right. Good morning. Good morning, Sister Nan Ruthie. How are you, beautiful one? So happy to have you today. Let us start off with a declaration for fathers Declaration prayer is a powerful, powerful prayer of speaking forth the blessings of God. And today's declaration comes from Pastor Matthew Gargano. And so he writes, and we just come together in the Lord's name to honor our fathers and what it means to be a father in this day and age where fathers, a lot of times, it's a really difficult for dads, the pressures of providing for the family, the pressures of time and being spread thin, and the pressures also of, the roles of the family figures and, just a commemoration to dads everywhere today. So this is the declaration. To all the fathers on this special day, I call forth the Father of us all to release the blessing of Moses upon you. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. And that's from Deuteronomy 34:7. I also call forth the Abrahamic blessing to rest upon you always, fathers. It is written, I, the Lord your God, have made you a father of many nations. I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come, to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. Genesis 17, verse 6 through 7. And for all the unreconciled fathers to their sons and daughters, I call forth the reconciliation that the Lord has intended from the beginning, starting with the fathers. And I decree and declare that the breach between you and your seed is repaired and restored. And never again will the enemy be allowed to tear apart what God has brought together. God bless you, men of God, on this very special day, as we honor the one who has made us in his image, God, the Father of us all. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for this blessing. Lord, thank you for the power of your blood that gives us protection and, Lord, restoration. Just as this declaration decreed that any breach between the daughters, sons, and their fathers, any breach between a father and his seed is repaired and restored in Jesus' name. And never again will the enemy be allowed to tear apart what God has brought together. Amen. Amen. The enemy loves to tear apart families because it's just such a direct hit. It is such a hit which causes an aftermath of pain for a lot of members, and it has all sorts of consequences. And a lot of times, marriages are tough, and it's hard to stay the course. And a lot of times, families go through really hard things. You know, children that are ills, children that perhaps make decisions, fall in with the wrong crowd, get involved in drugs or, you know, the wrong kind of influences. And it's really hard when the enemy goes to steal, kill, and destroy and try to make a wedge. But here, I love how there is this declaration of healing and repair and restoration to families, because the Lord can heal in an instant. So we just pray for healing in families. We pray for strength for the fathers, that they be restored to their rightful place as fathers, as men of God in all areas, in their family, in their workplace, in their community, and to be the light on the hill. Okay, happy Father's Day, Aurelia. Thank you for joining. Hubby says it's golfing with his son. Oh, that's so nice. And then we will get together with both kids' families for a barbecue. That's so wonderful. I gifted both of my fathers before I left Ohio on Thursday. That's so beautiful. Nothing like a nice get together, a barbecue, and taking it easy. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit, share with you my dad. His name is Richard. And on this Father's Day, I'm so grateful for my dad. I'll show you a picture of him here. There are a few pictures of Richard. There he is on his wedding day with his mom. And my parents are both from Poland. They actually met here in New Jersey they had a Polish dance, they had a Polish people's home here, and the Polish community would get together, and they actually met at one of these dances. And so here they are, married, and through different, stages of their life and different phases. And there's my dad on the lower left when he was just a kid, and he came to St. Louis to see his father. And I always love this picture because I always think, I used to tell my dad, "Hey, Dad, you look like a young Vladimir Horowitz in that picture." And Vladimir Horowitz, when I was growing up, was my piano hero. So I was like, is there any relation? Oh, man. But my dad, I'm always amazed at how people did it. I'm always amazed, like, how my dad particularly did it. Coming from Poland, not knowing anything about America, just taking a chance on life, coming over here on a ship with his buddy. Well, they met on the ship, actually, but they became fast friends. His name is Andrew. And, just how they made a life here, how they just learned the language, how they learned the, skills to live in this new country. And my dad has taught me so many things, because he really made it in this country. He has experienced the American dream because of his incredible discipline, self-discipline, and work ethic. And in so many areas, my father is my hero. And here I have a hero jar. And there's a story behind this hero jar. You know what hero is? Hero is a kind of jam. So you might think, like, what is this jam jar doing here? And it's called hero, which is kind of an amazing play on words and connection because, growing up, my father was always working and figuring out things. We never had to have a repairman for anything. If there was something wrong with the electric, he would fix it. If there was something wrong with the car, he would get a manual, he would figure it out, he would fix it. If there was something wrong with an appliance, he would fix it. My parents both renovated houses from soup to nuts, just figuring it out. And on weekends, that's what we would do, like sand the floors or paint or zip strip things, the window panes and stuff. It was tough in the beginning, and my parents didn't have enough, a lot of money. But what was amazing about my dad was that he didn't just have one job. When he would get back from his day job, he would always be working, doing other things, and figuring things out. In fact, there was even a time when my dad was figuring out how to repair old cars and resell them on the driveway. And it was amazing. He was so resourceful. And he also was resourceful to provide for the family. And a lot of times he just would go without so many things. He didn't really spend money on, a lot of things that we spend money on, fancy clothes, fancy electronics, in order to give us more. The things we needed, good education, the ability to, go shopping, have nice clothes, and things like that. But he spared himself, and he would work. I mean, always. I don't think there was a day in my life where I didn't see my father work. And starting really early, like 6 a.m., to sometimes not getting home till 12, midnight. The incredible work ethic. And one day, you know, my father has always been such a supporter of the piano and music in my life. And so in 2007, when my piano had just, it needed so many repairs, it had gotten to the point where I just could not even, it didn't make sense to channel more money into it because there was so many broken things in that piano. And to afford the type of piano that I dreamed of, it was just like way beyond what I could even imagine. And then one day my father called me up on the phone and he said, you don't have a piano right now to work on, right? What are you working on? I said, well, I have an electric piano, but you know, I'm making do with that. He said, I want you to go to New York. I want you to go to find yourself a piano and I'll take care of it. And I was like, what? What? And yeah, and next day he came and he gave me this, a hero jar filled with cash that he had stashed away for that purpose. And it took him years to save all that. And I mean, it's a piano that I have recorded on. In fact, the piece that I will share with you today was recorded on that piano. And it was a dream that surpassed like anything in my imagination. I wrote about it in my book called Soli Deo Gloria, An Anthem of Faith. You know, that's one of the stories in this book. And I use this as a segue because it's really a story about the life of J.S. Bach in episodes. And episodes also from my life, the music that he wrote, and it kind of is like a patchwork quilt of sorts. Yes, sister, yes, the Lord honors humble and honest work and a tender heart. And it is so true. There is such a, not beyond a feeling of satisfaction when it comes to work, but it also steadies the mind. And there used to be a saying that somebody once told me, like, idle hands are the devil's helper. And it really, there's a lot to that. Like when there's too much free time, when there isn't enough, you know, not just busy work, but if you don't apply yourself towards honest, good work, sometimes the mind can start to go veering, looking for, you know, other things to occupy itself that might not be in God's plan. So yes, honest work and achieving goals, there's something that's so profoundly valuable about that. And I always think that Jesus worked too. Oh, thank you, Jamie. You appreciate that story. I think I told you that one, right? Anyway, it is such a beautiful story because, I waited a long time for, you know, a piano that would be the type of piano I could do recordings on. That was always my dream, to have a recording studio. And I never thought that I would have a 9-foot concert grand in my home, which is the kind of pianos you see on stages, world stages. And the fact of the matter was that God made a way where there was no way and brought a piano beyond my dreams into my life. But again, it was only possible because there was that sacrifice. And it's something I'm forever indebted for. Now, Bach, J.S. Bach, who was born in 1685 and lived until 1750, was an amazing man. Beyond, I mean, it's like amazing is not quite even the description. Hardworking, I mean, beyond. Disciplined beyond, talented beyond, but again, he worked hard to really fulfill the talent that was put in him. And he worked so hard for one reason. It was to God the glory, for the glory of God. His music, every note was written for the glory of God. And as we spoke in earlier broadcasts, there is the power of the Holy Spirit inside this music, that that joy. There is that rhythm of life that pulsates through it. And I'd just like to show you the phenomenon that Bach was. You might see here, it's a sun. And what is this? This is an 18th century depiction of, at the time, who were the main composers. And it's a sun of composers. So in the middle of the sun, in the triangle, you see the name Johann Sebastian Bach. Around him, you might find some familiar names. Haydn, Handel. There was another composer we don't hear about much. Graun was his name. But if you look around, you see also Mozart's name. You see Gluck and other famous composers of the time. But the center is J.S. Bach. And the center was then and will always be in music, J.S. Bach. They're simply, definitively, across the board, there is no greater composer who achieved the height of music in all its compositional, technical complexity, emotional, you name it, dramatic scope. He just had the ultimate understanding of how to create music, and he created a tremendous amount of music in his life. In fact, it would take anybody working full-time, 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, it would take someone 50 years just to copy down the immense amount of music that Bach left us. Not to mention that half of it was lost. So it just boggles the mind, considering that Bach lived only 65 years. Superhuman ability to write music, but at a tremendous personal cost, because he was largely self-taught. He taught himself through copying music. And the minuet that we just heard earlier, it is from a notebook that the Bach household kept. In fact, Bach started three such notebooks for the education of his children. And I might need to mention here that Bach had, guess how many children? Does anybody know in the chat how many children did Bach have? In addition to not only being this prolific, beyond prolific composer, in addition to having all sorts of duties outside of composing, directing the music for churches, organist, teacher, he taught Latin even, he had pupils, he had 20 children. He had 20 children, and he was a devoted family man on top of everything else. I'm going to read an excerpt from my book. It's called A Time to Dance, and it's just a picture of the Bach household, the Bach family, which was a very large family, and every year they would gather for reunions, and it was indeed a time to dance. And so I preface this with Psalm 149:3, praise his name with dancing accompanied by drums and lyre. The sun streamed through the cloudless sky, warming the cracked dry soil with the promise of summer. Blades of grass rose from the ground, tickling the bare feet of the dancers as they spun around merrily, stomping their heels in a rustic folk style while the band of musicians played. It was a beautiful early summer day in Erfurt, Germany, with a perfect blue sky to adorn the most special of celebrations. And the occasion was the annual Bach family reunion. The whole Bach clan turned out for the fun. Part of the clan improvised tunes on lutes and violins to entertain the crowd, while some assembled into a circle to dance. Children were running as they played a feisty game of tag, weaving through the crowd with their excited giggles. A group of men were heard laughing and telling jokes near the barrel of beer that was flowing throughout the day. The savory smell of bratwurst and cabbage was wafting through the air as a small group of women were carefully putting the finishing touches on the delicate pastries that would soon be served for dessert. For an outsider looking in, it was easy to see that the Bach family was a sizable one, bustling with energy and a contagious zeal for living. The Bachs had begun their animated festivities in the late morning, commencing the proceedings in a surprisingly solemn fashion. After exchanging hearty greetings, they gathered to sing staunch Lutheran chorales. The talented Bach clan, all of them skilled in music, formed a resonant and impressive choir. The chorales, sung in harmony, were meant to fulfill their first duty, which was to honor God. By doing so, they ushered in the festivities with reverence, petitioned God for blessing on the family, and offered thanksgiving to the Lord for the year of provision they had enjoyed. It's a kind of fictional account I made in my mind of what those reunions must have been like, because there was so much music making, there was so much surrounded by enjoyment of each other and enjoyment of music. And indeed, Bach wrote so many dances. The minuet we just heard is one of those types of dances, and so many more. If you're interested in Bach dances, you might want to listen to the suites he wrote, the French suites and the English suites that were written for the keyboard instruments. And it's just a collection of different dance forms. And they're just so delightful. They're so different. And each of them comes from a different type of origin. There's some dances that have more of a French mood to them, a character like the minuet. There's some that have more of a Germanic, like Allemande, was a type of dance. So it's just a pastiche, like a prism of beautiful dances. 16 children. You were close, Kit. You were close. 20 Bach children. So now I'd like to, let me just see what I have here. Okay. I'd like to now segue to another famous composer who was also put family on a very special pedestal in his life, and that is Sergei Rachmaninoff. And Rachmaninoff was born in the late 1800s in Russia, and he came from a somewhat well-to-do Russian family. And from an early age, Rachmaninoff's talents were easy to see. And so he was in a class in the conservatory, in fact, lived in the home of a famous teacher in Russia. And he had to, it was like a kind of boarding situation where other students, including the composer Alexander Scriabin, were also housed in the teacher, his name was Verev. And they were all living in this house. But there was one problem that Rachmaninoff had, and it was the fact that he wanted to compose and he needed a piano to compose on, but there was the living room at this house where the pianos were. So there was always competition for time to practice, because always there was somebody in that room using the piano for piano practicing. And Rachmaninoff was one of the greatest pianists of history, to boot, in addition to being an amazing composer. And so he asked his teacher for permission to have a piano dedicated for just composition that he can use. And the teacher got very frustrated at that request. Why? Because he wanted piano playing and piano performance to be the number one thing in the house. He didn't want just people using it for composition. And so there was a little bit of tension and friction. Now, what happened next has to do with the love story that Rachmaninoff was to experience in his life, but a love story that would also go through a road of deep suffering. So to make a long story short, Rachmaninoff's relative, his aunt, actually then took Rachmaninoff in under the request of Rachmaninoff's teacher, because she had a piano and she could give Sergei the environment he needed to continue his studies and work on his composition. And in that home was also a girl named Natalia. And her name was Natalia Satina, and she was actually the first cousin of Rachmaninoff, very young at that time. And so their story was interesting, because when Rachmaninoff began his career, he made a debut of his first symphony. And the first symphony was in the newspapers following the premiere performance. It was absolutely torn into shreds by the critic, who called it music suitable to be heard only in the depths of Dante's Inferno of Hell. And it broke Rachmaninoff. This criticism, just for a sensitive person, and if you know Rachmaninoff's music, like his second piano concerto, his amazing, all his piano concertos, symphonies, songs, I mean, they're just the most romantic and luscious and sensitive and beautiful things. And this criticism broke Rachmaninoff, and he plunged into a deep depression in his 20s. And it was in this deep depression that he stopped composing. He just stopped having a desire for living. And if you are interested more of this story, I did an episode, a video on my YouTube channel about this, entitled something about when words of criticism, you know, how dealing with words of criticism and the story of Rachmaninoff. Rachmaninoff was for 4 long years in this helpless, depressive state. And it was only through the power of the spoken word that he was able to get out of it. So again, when we pray our prayers out loud, when we declare, as we just declared a Father's Day declaration, it's not only that it's words, it's energy. It is producing. It is the creative force of the universe. So that is what got Rachmaninoff out of it. And also after that four-year period, he, under really tough circumstances, he was in love with Natalia. It was difficult to marry his first cousin. The Orthodox Russian Church was kind of like, we don't want to do this. It was still difficult. And so, but after going through all these hurdles, they did actually get married. Eventually they moved to the States. They had 2 healthy, wonderful daughters. And I just would like to show you this picture of Rachmaninoff with his grandchild. And it's such a beautiful picture, because Rachmaninoff is oftentimes photographed, and in the pictures, he looks very austere. He was a very tall man. He was a very, he had these very remarkable features. And the way he's such a, kind, soft, and beautiful human, the way he's looking at the grandchild here is, and he writes, this was written to Mr. Steinway, the founder of Steinway Pianos, and he said, to Mr. John Steinway, from a grandfather in love. Isn't that so beautiful? Isn't that just so beautiful? I'd also like to play for you a clip. This is a really archived clip of Rachmaninoff, and when there were family get-togethers at his estate, which I believe was in Riverdale, New York. I might be wrong about that, but in any case, it's just a beautiful picture of a family life just having fun together, which, you know, is, you know, what memories are really made of. So I just like to show you this Rachmaninoff movie.
I would like to add that for over 20 years, I had the privilege of dealing with Rachmaninoff in a business way through my connection with Steinway & Sons. So all these years, I've never had the slightest misunderstanding with the great composer and pianist, who was one of the most considerate men business-wise. His punctuality was proverbial. If he said he would come at 10 o'clock, it was not 5 minutes past 10 or 5 minutes to 10. It was exactly 10 o'clock. But just as exact he was in everything, he expected the same exactness from all the people with whom he dealt. And perhaps because I also am punctual, we had never the slightest misunderstanding. If anything happened, let me say to the piano, all I had to do was to telephone him or write him, but just telling him about it. And he would fully understand, never complain. He was never fussy. He knew what he wanted, and all he expected was careful attention to everything that was to be done. It was not only a privilege, it was a real pleasure to deal with an artist who was so considerate, so understanding in everything. If something was done to please him, he would never forget to say thank you. Every day, every year, when he arrived for his concert tour from Europe, one of his first visits was to Steinway Hall to greet our president, Mr. Theodore Steinway. And always, at the end of the tour, before he left for his home in Switzerland, he would come.
It's just, isn't it just so precious, the way that he is, like, just, you know, playing around with his family and the way he's cuddling with his grandchild. And it's just, the love is so incredible. Rachmaninoff had a really tough life in Russia because of the revolution. They literally took away his beloved country home. And, you know, he just had to rebuild everything. It's just such a tribute to fathers in different situations, whether, you know, it's a story like my dad leaving Poland to come to America and, you know, build everything from the beginning, or a story like Rachmaninoff's, like having all this and then losing it completely and then having to rebuild a life. Or my husband, who came from Germany as a 29-year-old to America and just, you know, had to make a life and start and learn the, you know, nuances of life in America, and also the nuances of marrying a crazy Polish pianist like me and dealing with all the things that come with that. I give him a lot of credit. Wonderful, wonderful husband. And, you know, so I just want to also mention, didn't you think it was just so beautiful? And I know the footage wasn't great quality, but when I saw the Rachmaninoff footage, I thought, that is just pure, clean fun, right? Like, just enjoying each other's company. It wasn't fancy. It was like outside. It was, you know, just hanging around a table. It was maybe, you know, like going on a little rowboat ride. I mean, those are the things of life. And even when we started and we heard the minuet from Bach's notebook for his family that he kept, I was struck by the preface to this notebook, because it talks about what is really truly important, which sometimes in this modern day, everything being very technology based, virtual, especially now with, you know, like what we've all gone through with the COVID time and everything, what is really truly valuable, in time together, how valuable that is. And with the notebook that they kept, that they used, like they would always put new things into the notebook, and it was a living document. And so the preface says that music in that time was too much regarded as a living thing to be confined exclusively to the realm of goods that could be bought in the store. We now, if we need sheet music, we just go to Amazon and we get sheet music. But in those days, it was, again, there was such, music was so living that in order to really internalize the music, you would copy it and it would go through every cell of your being. Even if the listening or performing experience preceded or followed the act of purchase, the true music lover was not satisfied. The piece had to be copied in order to become really and intimately his own. So on that note, I would like to conclude the broadcast by sharing with you a beautiful piece of music originally written by Bach, and it's called I Thank You, Lord. And Rachmaninoff loved that melody, and he took it and arranged it for piano. So it's Bach-Rachmaninoff arrangement of I Thank You, Lord. And it's a prayer. And so, you know, right before we listen to it, I would like to thank you so much for being here on this Father's Day, and just like to offer as a concluding prayer that we pray the Our Father together, and just Lord, praising your holy name and thanking you, Lord, for the gift of fathers. Lord, just praying every spiritual blessing of protection, strength, favor that surpasses, and peace that surpasses all understanding upon all the fathers and families out there, Lord, your healing grace, your healing power upon all the relationships perhaps that are broken between fathers and their children, Lord, praying for new breath, new life, new energy, new life force. And Lord, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Here is the Bach-Rachmaninoff, I Thank You, Lord. Thank you. Okay, so isn't that just such a vibrant piece? So alive, so rich, and it's like a boost of vitamin C. If you are interested in reading more about the spiritual life and journey of J.S. Bach, and not in a musicological kind of way, it's not dry, it's got episodes from Bach's life spanning from when he took a 250-mile walk to hear the great organist Buxtehude play in Lübeck. He risked his life. I would say, yeah, he risked his life. He risked his job. He risked security in order to do it, to get to the next level of his anointing. These incredible stories that we don't hear much, and interwoven with scripture, and interwoven with just real stories from I share from my life, from other preaching, and so this is all together in this collection, and I try to make it also as you listen to the music, and it has an accompanying chapter, so you can use it as a prayer. So, for instance, the piece we just heard is a thankfulness to God, and so that goes along with a chapter I wrote entitled "Lead Me, Teach Me, for You Are the God That Gives Me Salvation." And so, talking about the trials that Bach had in his life, personal trials that I've had, and that have found solace in the scripture and in the music of Bach. So it's unlike other books, is what I'm trying to say, because I try to go deeper into having it more of a spiritual experience of the music rather than just a dry biographical accounting of a composer's life. So that is available on Prayer Piano or on Amazon, and it comes with the CD. So, any case, that is available, and I just want to thank you again for joining on this broadcast. It's always such a joy to spend Sundays with you. Oh, Monica, hello. Oh, such a sweetheart. It's so great to see you here. Yes, Ron, thank you. Yeah, isn't that an amazing arrangement? Rachmaninoff brings sparkle to everything he played at the piano. I mean, sparkle. Rachmaninoff, the three piano concertos are a must. His chamber music is a must to hear. His symphonies are a must. His variations on a theme of Paganini are absolutely sublime. There's so much great music. I hope to share with you more of Rachmaninoff's music live in for a future broadcast. I will be preparing that. And just there's just such a musical richness, tapestry to explore. And it really is so elevating. We'll never have another Rachmaninoff. We'll never have anything even close to a Bach again. The classical period lasted a drop in the bucket of human history, about 200, maybe 30 years. And it's just this jewel, and the crown of humanity, never to be repeated. We'll never have music like this again. So it's just a joy to be able to share the glory that God put through music, through the hands of these wonderful composers that had such a handle on harmony. And of course, we know that harmony works with its own laws. There is a sense of direction, there's a sense of completion, tension, and release, just like life. And the composers ranging from Bach to Rachmaninoff, which really spans most of the classical music era. And again, that's like a 200-year span only. But they put perfected this idea of music using the laws of harmony, which incidentally are a reflection of the laws of nature. Every flower we see, every seashell, the way that the galaxies look like is actually reflected in the structure of these great masterworks. Things like the golden triangle, the golden mean, the law of thirds. These are all things that the composers knew very well. And they also knew that if they used it in the structure of their compositions, in the harmonic language that they used, that they could affect a transformative effect on people. So really, truly, when we can start to listen a Beethoven sonata, by the end of it, the whole goal is that we are transformed, that something has shifted, that something that was maybe troubling us has, through the power of this journey of that classical piece, it has now been lifted and shifted, both through the arrangement of the music and through the vibrational things, the vibrational alignments that the composer also integrated into the piece. So there's a lot of power when we listen to the great masterwork. So we can use music not only as entertainment, as we read about the Bach family, when they got together, they danced entertainment. We can use music also for reflection, just like Psalms and King David. You know, there's different Psalms. You know, there's some Psalms that are more reflective. There are some Psalms that are about praise. We just heard Bach-Rachmaninoff. That's a Psalm of praise, right? We hear Psalms of lament, surely in classical music. If we hear pieces like even the Chopin Prelude in E minor, isn't that a lament? That's a lament, you know, that's another type of psalm we can have. So there are so many different types of transformative experiences we could have through the great classical works, which is why we get together every Sunday to experience them for the glory of God. So thank you for joining today. I wish you again a most blessed and wonderful Father's Day to all the dads out there and granddads. Happy Father's Day. Be blessed, be joyful, be healthy. And I look forward to seeing you next week at our next prayer piano broadcast, where we will be picking up where we left off with Schubert and more. Okay, so have a wonderful Sunday. God bless. Thanks for joining.